There are 5 million homes in Britain, provided at reduced rent through local councils.
Yes, a nice size.
A further 4.5 million people are on the waiting list for somewhere to live.
Now I will take anything, because I'd take anything rather than be on the streets.
I'm a worker, so I think I should be one of the first priorities.
With the government cutting benefits for unemployed households and private rental prices hitting new heights, demand for council housing has gone through the roof.
Yeah, the clock's ticking fast.
There are 95 people in front of me in this. I don't know, what's the point of applying for it? What's the point?
There's this misconception that, oh, it's all right, the council will sort me out. Not anymore.
These people all want a home. But who needs it the most?
There's two people in front of me that could accept the property. Fingers crossed they don't.
Tower Hamlets in East London. A host borough for the Olympics, it's now one of the most expensive places to buy or rent property in the UK. But it's also one of the poorest areas in the country. For many facing cuts to their benefits because of government welfare reforms, it's becoming almost impossible to afford to live here.
The benefit cap has been implemented by the government, and it limits people who are out of work to a maximum of £500 a week for a family or £350 a week for a single person.
The government argues the cap will encourage unemployed people back to work and reduce the UK's soaring welfare bill.
It's predicted that by the end of 2015, we're going to be spending £22 billion a year just on housing benefit. Now, that's not sustainable.
For those who can't find work, the best hope of staying in the borough is to secure a council house, where rents can be significantly cheaper. Property that's soon to become available include a two-bed maisonette on the seventh floor of this tower block for £139 a week. This recently refurbished one-bed flat for £155 a week. And this three-bed flat with city views in a brand new complex for £168 a week. But competition for places is fierce.
How are you getting on with your search?
Still the same.
Very hard, isn't it?
I would say it's almost impossible.
20,000 households are looking for a council property in Tower Hamlets, fighting for just 2,000 available places a year.
I don't want to jump the queue, but I'm just hoping that they'll be able to help me, and if they can't, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Brian and the team have hundreds of households on their books that are being affected by the cap.
Sabina to interview room 16, please.
Today he's meeting 34-year-old Sabina.
Hey, yeah.
Hi there. Take a seat, please.
Sabina's been on the council house waiting list for just over 4 years.
So how long is the wait on mine then?
I'll show you your bidding at the moment. So you've got a 304, a 509 and a 314. You don't get to view properties until you achieve top three or top five queue positions. So I would say that we're talking several years. The reality is, unless you've got 8 to 10 years bidding on the list, you don't stand a chance. You don't stand any chance at all of getting housed, but people don't want to hear that.
Sabina currently lives in a privately rented four-bedroom house with her husband and five children.
She likes making funny faces.
As they're both out of work, they're entirely dependent on benefits and were previously entitled to £767 a week. Now their total benefits have been cut to just £500 a week.
You're going to have your breakfast now. Is it nice?
Yum, yum.
The rent on Sabina's property is currently £375 a week. But once she's paid for all her bills and household costs, A cap of £500 will leave her with just £84 for rent.
Not very happy about it, really, at all. With five kids, it's really difficult to cut down on food, clothing and stuff, and it's not just hitting myself, it's just hitting the kids as well.
The council have been covering the £267 a week shortfall in Sabina's rent out of its emergency funds. But that money is running out.
Realistically, with the £500 cap, that property is no longer viable for you to live in.
But if we do find ourselves a property...
I don't see how you're going to do that.
Because what we do is, because obviously my husband's going to start work, and in between we're just paying with our benefit money and stuff.
Yeah, but you're only getting £88 a week in housing benefit?
Yeah, and then we pay the rest with the benefit money.
Where are you...
The child tax, child benefit, and then job seeker.
It's just not sustainable. You know, that's not what that money's meant for.
Right.
You know, so that means you putting your family through hardship to use the money that should be spent on their clothes and food and whatever else on rent.
But I've got money left over to pay the bills and stuff because I just got to cut on the, you know, sort of like extra mobiles and Sky and all this.
You've still got Sky?
Yeah.
Okay. Those were the kind of expenses I would have said you needed to...
expensive stuff I could cut off.
Yeah.
And then sort of, you know.
I think Tower Hamlets is too expensive for you.
But if we paid it.
You can't pay that indefinitely.
Because obviously the situation's going to change because my husband's going to get a job and I'm going to get sort of like 16 hours a week job.
I deal with people every day who say, I'm going to find a job. 18 months later, they haven't found a job. So, you know, financially, is it worth you staying in London?
I'm shocked that he said to move outside of London because, you know, you can't get a job up there and you've got no families and stuff to support. And you've got sort of like, it's going to be difficult to get a work and then find a childcare.
It's a financial motivation that the government's decided upon. So if you want to live in the most expensive part of the most expensive city in the country, they think that you need to be contributing to the economy. If you're not able to do that, then unfortunately you're going to have to move.
44-year-old Londoner Ray has lived in Tower Hamlets for 8 years. He currently lives in an ex-council bedsit, bought under the right to buy scheme, but his landlord wants to refurbish it and has told Ray to leave today.
I'm worried that they might have the audacity to try and come round and actually force me out of the house, you know. It hasn't happened yet, and it's now 11:30. I don't know if they're giving me time to wake up or giving me time to move out.
Ray is desperate for his own council house. Out of work because of health issues, the rent for his bedsit is paid for by housing benefit.
Because I've got a 14-year-old son, and I haven't seen him since he's 1.5, which is really quite sad, but I live with it today. I've done a lot of crying over it and a lot of thinking about it, but now it's something I just live with. And, you know, I think being settled and being in a place where I can do up and, you know, make look nice and all that, just in case one day my son contacts me, you know, which would be really great, which I wish would happen and pray would happen every single night.
After losing all contact with his son, Ray's life spiralled out of control.
I was basically a crackhead and drink dependent and all that, and I ended up getting arrested for drink driving, and I went to prison for it, thank God. You know, we get punished for the things we do.
Now clean and sober, if Ray is evicted, he'll have nowhere else to go. After standing guard for most of the morning, he takes matters into his own hands.
I'm going to phone my landlord now, see what's happening. Is he going to send someone around today to board it up or whatever, you know? Here we go. Like, I'm just... How long does the bailiff take? Oh, no, you're joking.
Is that right?
Oh, my God. I've got plenty of time. They've... why didn't I just phone them up in the first place? They've said to me that, they've applied to go to court for the bailiffs, but that could take anything up to 3 months. That just gives me more time to sort things out with the council.
Ray's had a stay of execution, but his best hope of staying in Tower Hamlets is to find a council property. He's been on a waiting list and bidding for a place for 7 years, but so far with no luck.
The way the bidding system works is that we have a list of proper accommodations that become available each week. The applicants then make an informed decision as to whether or not they wish to be considered for that particular property by placing a bid.
People's position in the queue is determined by their level of need and how long they've been on the list.
There's a new one, and there's 67 people in front of me.
How long does that mean you've got to wait?
I don't know, 6 or 7 years. I don't know. Until 67 people die, or I don't know, what's it mean? I'm a vulnerable person, I'm an ex-addict, I'm an ex-alcoholic, and I'm stuck in this system, and it's really frustrating. You know, there's lots of questions to be asked about this system, but the main one is, can I have a flat, please?
Tower Hamlets in East London is one of the most densely populated boroughs in Britain. With the cost of rental prices rising by 16% in the last year, living here is becoming unaffordable for anyone who is on benefits and out of work. And this is putting an enormous strain on the council's housing office.
Afternoon, Sir Patrick Evans, Tower Hamlets.
Demand is increasing. Supply is dropping. Individuals' financial ability to pay is also dropping. I do think there is a crisis looming. Our job is to try and minimise the impact of that crisis.
Where did I put the hair clips? I had loads this morning. Oh, they're in my hair. I put them in my hair so I wouldn't lose them. And then I lost them. Come quick, because that sun's in my eyes.
For the past 3 years, single mother Lacey has been living in this privately rented three-bedroom flat with her two daughters and son, who has recently been diagnosed with autism. The property costs £365 a week to rent. But the benefit cap leaves Lacey with only £217 a week to spend on housing.
Benefit cap, I don't see how that's working at all, because you're pushing me back and standing on me and keeping me there rather than helping me go in the right direction where I should be going into terms of finding a job.
For lone parents, getting just 16 hours a week of work would see them qualify for working tax credit and stop their benefits being capped.
16 hours seems like it's a realistic amount of hours to work, but who's going to have the kids while you're working?
Unless Lacey can find employment, her best prospect of staying in the borough is to get a council property.
Let's have a quick look and see where you are. I would say you're doing quite well with it, because there was a property you bid for in January that you came number six, which was very good. This property here. All I can say is when you bid for property, just be flexible in terms of the area, in terms of the level of property. But finger crossed, you know, it might be something coming through to you.
So there's a chance.
There is a chance, but it's just the urgency in your case.
Although Lacey's position on the waiting list is encouraging, her need to find somewhere has become critical. Her landlord has issued her with a bailiff's warrant, and she's due to be evicted in just under 2 weeks' time.
Yeah, the clock's ticking. Oh, fast. Because in less than 2 weeks, I'm going to be homeless. And my three kids are going to be homeless. Well, I'm struggling to sort of keep on top of it and keep, you know, keep my head sort of together.
Lacey returned to her home borough of Tower Hamlets and went on benefits after splitting from her husband, who was in the armed forces.
I suppose at the minute my biggest fear is social services maybe stepping in and getting involved. You know, I mean, they're not involved as of now, but I don't know, that's my biggest fear. That's the strongest fear.
Ready? Steady, let's go. Coming out quick.
Just waiting, seeing what turns up. Keep applying for jobs, keep my head up. Try and keep a smile on my face for my kids and just keep going.
Providing they've been living in the borough for 3 years, anyone can apply for a council house in Tower Hamlets. But the waiting list is based on a complex calculation that takes into account the amount of time a person is in the queue and also their level of need.
But we're here to make sure that the people that deserve the property and the people that who are in great need are those that we assess and place on the housing list.
30-year-old teaching assistant Sabrina still lives at home with her mum.
Right, this room here is my bedroom. It's the biggest room in the house. Spend most of my time in this room. And here's the smallest room, which is my nephew's bedroom.
Sabrina has lived in this four-bedroom house all her life.
This is my mother's room. And we have another bedroom, but that's our laundry room.
Sabrina's mother owns this property, but now Sabrina wants a place of her own.
It's just independence. That's the only reason why I want to move on. I'm happy where I live, but I'm 30 now, and I would like to have my own space. Let's see what they have here.
Almost every week for the past 12 years, Sabrina has been bidding for council properties. She's seen places like this one-bed flat, available for £123 a week, and this ground floor two-bed flat for £125 a week come and go because she is considered low priority by the council.
I don't think the system works really well because I know others that have been on the list after me and has got a place. So I don't see the fairness in that. And on top of that, she's on benefits. So how can you be on the list after me, not working for it, and you get a place? If we're working for it, we should be first priority. Not people that are living on our money as it is already, living off my tax money.
...44-year-old Ray, whose only income is from benefits, is facing eviction and urgently needs to find new accommodation. Staying in Tower Hamlets depends on him getting a council house or finding a private rental flat that he can afford with his housing benefit.
Bloody hell. 350, one bedroom apartment. I'll get 240 a week. The cheapest flat for me here in this shop window is 285 a week. On my income support, I don't get enough to pay for that. It's absolutely impossible. So I've got no chance in this place.
But finding an affordable flat is only half the challenge.
150 a week, 130 a week, double room. That looks really nice. Oh, bloody hell. Sorry, no DSSS. No point in stopping here then. No DSSS. So the ones what are reasonably priced, they don't accept the HSS. And the ones what charge diabolical prices accept the HSS. Fantastic.
Can I ask you,
do you take people who are on benefits?
We do, but at the moment I don't have anything. You know, when we take on properties, we do ask landlord whether they would accept tenants on benefits.
Do you have any idea why some of them do and some of them don't?
Some just don't want the hassle because some of them think people who are on benefit, they don't look after the properties.
So would you say that it would probably be hard for me to get somewhere then?
Right now it's going to be hard because there isn't a lot of properties around. You know, the demand has really gone up. People with the money are pushing the poor out from the, especially into hamlets. It's kind of a cleansing of the poor.
We're facing the perfect storm. We have rents shooting up, rocketing up, in fact, out of the reaches of people on benefits. And we have letting agents and landlords who aren't interested in renting their properties to people on benefits. So, you know, nobody who's benefit dependent and not in a permanent property will be able to live in Tower Hamlets. And this is going to happen in the next 6 to 12 months.
One of those facing sizable cuts to her benefits is Sabina. Unemployed and with 5 children, the benefit cap leaves her facing a shortfall in her rent of £267 a week. She's come to the conclusion that she has to find somewhere cheaper to live.
We're moving to Barking today because the benefit cap they've done, it's too expensive and it's too high rent to live in Tower Hamlets, so we've decided to move to Barking.
Although Barking is just 7 miles away, rent prices are cheaper, but it means a big adjustment for the family.
It's quite difficult and quite sad because, like, there'll be, like, people missing us and everything, and, like, it's going to be kind of weird moving to Barking because there ain't that many people that I know that live around there, so, yeah.
By moving out of the borough, Sabina loses her position on the Tower Hamlets waiting list.
How are you feeling?
Not that bad.
Are you sad to be leaving Tower Hamlets, though?
Yeah.
Jump in here.
It's not fair because just had to start all over again.
Without a benefit cap, you know, I would have not moved, to be honest. But because they've done a benefit cap, I had to move. I've got no choice.
Sabina may have left the borough, but the council officers had to deal with an average of 35 new applicants joining the waiting list every week.
Okay, so that you can...
That's good, you're attending interviews. Excellent.
Single mother Lacey is one of those desperate for a council house. She and her 3 children are faced with eviction in just under 2 weeks' time. After bidding for a 2-bedroom housing association place, Lacey has found out that she's 3rd on the list for the property.
Nervous, excited. I don't know, mixed emotions, because I don't want to build my hopes up too much. There's 2 people in front of me that could potentially accept the property. Fingers crossed they don't.
The property is a maisonette on the 7th floor of this tower block.
I quite like the outside, looks quite cool.
On the private rental market, 2-bed flats in the area average around £379 a week. Through the Housing Association, this maisonette is being offered at a far more affordable £139. But Lacey needs 2 other families to turn it down before she can take it.
How hopeful are you?
I've lost hope.
This is a step in the right direction, but
again, I'm number three, you know?
If Lacey doesn't get this property, she and her children will be evicted and homeless in less than 2 weeks' time. The government's benefit cuts are aimed at encouraging people back to work. Unemployed family households can now only claim a maximum of £500 a week. In Tower Hamlets, it means many will be unable to cover their rent. And the council's housing office has been working all hours with people to assess what their options will be when the cap takes effect.
I just called to get an update on your housing situation.
Okay, it's just about your benefit cap, because obviously, you know, that might be a problem with regards to your rent.
I've been trying to get in touch with you for quite some time regarding your housing situation. Just over a third of tenants that I've contacted have got back to me, and I'm quite concerned that there are still a number of people who aren't engaging. So I'm going to need to start doing home visits, do a bit of door knocking to explain to them that, you know, they're in a situation that's unsustainable.
The emergency money the council had set aside to cover the rent of struggling households will soon be gone, leaving hundreds in rent arrears.
I'm just putting a card through the door with my details on, because she's obviously not at home. There is a massive dilemma here because, you know, you have people who are on benefits, they've been established in the community for a number of years, but unfortunately the areas are so expensive now that if you can't afford to pay the rent, you need to do as everyone else does and move to an affordable area.
Hi there, my name is Brian from Tower Hamlets Council. Can I talk to you about your housing benefit for a few minutes? Cheers, thank you very much.
26-year-old Billy is a single mother of four boys, all aged under eight.
This is Sunny and Charlie. Charlie's got a twin brother, he's seven. There's a baby Thomas with yogurt on him. Yeah.
Billy currently lives in this privately rented three-bedroom house, which costs £369 a week. She used to pay for this out of her £716 a week benefits.
I never wanted to ever be on benefits in the first place. But, you know, for some people, there comes a time when you have to swallow your pride and go to the dole office, which is what happened for me. It's not something that I ever planned, you know?
Hello,
yeah.
Billy.
Ready? Steady? Go! The whole world thinks that anyone who claims benefits is a bum and lazy and doesn't want to work. And that's not the case for everybody. You know, there's some people who do claim benefits because they need to, because there isn't another option for people like me. When my youngest son is old enough to go to school, there'll be nothing stopping me from spending every minute of every day trying to find employment.
The benefit cap will leave Billy with just £152 a week to cover her rent.
Okay, so you're facing a rent shortfall of £216.86 a week, which is one of the larger rent shortfalls that I'm dealing with. Not the largest that I have, but it's top end.
So far, the council's emergency fund has covered Billy's rent. But once that money runs out, Billy and her children will have to move to a cheaper private property.
There's nowhere within the M25 or even, you know, within the majority of this area that we can place you apart from right on the outskirts. Yeah. So it will be a big move rather than around the corner move.
Billy and her children's best chance of staying in the area is to secure a council property, which could cut her weekly rent by up to a half. But she's been bidding since she was 18, with no success.
I bid every week, and they do say that if you don't miss any bids, you bid every week, that you'll go further and further up the list. Which I just don't see any evidence of it. I've been bidding for 9 years. And I'm still waiting. It, it it doesn't, it just hasn't happened.
Okay, nice meeting you.
Unless Billy's luck changes in the next 2 months, she and her children face being uprooted from their home in Tower Hamlets.
Why do I have to be moved 20 miles away from anything that I've ever known? To bring up 4 kids in isolation, which is what it will feel like.
Take care, speak soon.
It feels like I can't control my future or my children's, and that boils down to me feeling like a bad mum.
Single mother of three, Lacey, is facing eviction from her privately rented flat, but recently had the chance to view a housing association property. She was hopeful it would give her and her children a new home, but she's received bad news.
That flat, I didn't get accepted for it because I was third on the list and the first people accepted it. Starting from scratch again, starting from square one. Having my hopes built up for something and then not getting it, you know?
The family's possessions are being moved into storage. Tomorrow, they will be evicted.
The moving man took the bed and a radio.
Lacey and her children are on the brink of becoming homeless, but she's trying to keep the news from them.
It's tough, you know? Pretending everything's normal, everything's fine. I just told him that we've got to move out of here because the landlord wants to move back into his properties. We might have to stay in a hotel. So I've made it sound like it's going to be fun.
Sit back down!
I told him that we have to share a kitchen and possibly a bathroom. So Aaron, being Aaron, my son, he asked if we was living with homeless people. So, yeah, we are, but obviously I ain't told him that. Because we're also homeless. Obviously, you don't know that.
After 12 years on the waiting list, teaching assistant Sabrina has been given the chance to view a flat.
My first impressions at the moment, the area seems okay. It's a quiet area. From the outside, it looks okay, but it depends what the inside looks like, to be honest with you.
This is a bedroom. It's quite spacious for a one-bedroom flat. Really nice.
It's all right. Yeah, it's a nice size.
Okay, let me show you the living room. It's really quite spacious as well.
Actually, this one's all right, this room, yeah.
Right, the kitchen's a newly refurbished kitchen with new units, new cupboards, new flooring, new tiles.
On the private market, one-bedroom flats like this in the area could cost £400 a week. But Sabrina is being offered it for just £155.
I'm just trying to work my monthly wages and trying to subtract all the things that will be coming out of my account. The rent, gas, electric, and it's quite a bit. This is beautiful, but it's out of my price range. £300 to live on a month is peanuts, yeah. That's nonsense.
So is this going to be a no, then?
Yeah, it's going to be a no.
It's a shame.
Basically, I'll just be working to pay bills. That will be my wages. Every month will be paying bills. That's it. The lifestyle that I live now and the things that I do now, I won't be able to do. But I'm just going to continue bidding, have patience, wait, hopefully another one like this will come along, but within my price range.
Tower Hamlet have set a table for how much we can charge. So whatever we charge for one bedroom or two bedroom properties would be a target that has been set within the borough.
So she's not going to get anything cheaper than this around the borough. So I just wish her the best.
While Sabrina is back to bidding, single mother of four, Billy, has had some good news. After 9 years on the council waiting list, she's been given the chance to view a flat. Joining Billy on her viewing today are her youngest son, Tom, and her brother, Eric.
I've been wondering sort of stupid scenarios, like, when I get there, what if they say, oh, no, we've changed our mind? What if they say, oh, somebody else has got more priority than you, so you're back down the list again? I know it's stupid, but I don't know, it just doesn't feel real yet.
In the last 4 years, the council has built 4,000 new houses. Billy's going to view a three-bedroom property in a new housing association development that will contain 208 flats.
There is still building going on, as you can see. So it's actually brand new. Oh, this looks amazing. Look, the balconies aren't finished. The balconies aren't even on. So it's literally brand new. There's no one's ever lived in it before. I will be the first. I just want to get in there now. I literally just want to get in there and see what it's like.
Because building work is still underway, Billy has to leave her son and brother outside and view the property on her own. On the private rental market, the starting price for a three-bed flat in this area is around £470 a week. Circle Housing offered this at a reduced rent of £168 a week, around £200 cheaper than her current accommodation. In 2 months' time, 62 social housing homes will open in this block, and Billy and her family will move into one of them.
It's really nice, it's lovely. The bedrooms are all nice size. The bedrooms are all bigger than my bedrooms at home. That's the kitchen and the living room.
The kitchen's big.
It's nice, isn't it?
Look.
It means that we're going to be happy now. We're going to be happy and comfortable. I can leave all my stress behind and start, you know, being happy and making a life for us all.
As Billy Joe looks forward to moving in, Ray is anxious about having to move out. He's due to be evicted from his bedsit and is heading to the council for help.
I haven't got anyone else I can go to, so if they don't help me, I'm just going to pitch a tent outside the office and live there. Because that's my only option. I've got a roof over my head at this precise moment in time, but I'm being evicted and I never made myself intentionally evicted. So if you think that, oh, look at this geezer, he's got a roof over his head, what is it, what's he moaning about? And guess what, fuck you.
Single mum Lacey was evicted from her privately rented flat this morning. With her children at school, she's come into the council office to see what emergency housing they can provide.
All right, thank you.
We've always been proud of our ability to house our homeless families in Borough. But that's becoming increasingly difficult. And we're finding ourselves now searching accommodation outside of our own borough boundaries. And you can imagine the consequences of that to our homeless families.
The stress is unreal. Because obviously you've got to take into consideration how the kids are feeling. You know, I'm responsible for my three kids, solely responsible for my three kids. So I have to take that seriously. So yeah, how this affects me is going to affect them. And the stress, I can't put it into words, the stress.
Lacey to booth 17.
Because she has children, Lacey knows the council are obliged to find her emergency accommodation.
Thank you.
Hi, Lacey.
Hi.
My name's Mohammed.
But depending on what's available, It could be anything from a house in the borough to a bed and breakfast in another part of the country.
Originally, we did have plans to put you into a B&B accommodation. But thankfully, you've been given a temporary accommodation. You know, it doesn't happen on many occasions, but when it does happen, you know, this is quite rare. So that's a good result for us, yeah. No problem.
Cheers, mate.
Take care. See ya.
Cheers, see ya.
Temporary accommodation is usually a self-contained flat in which a family can live until a permanent place becomes available.
Very relieved. The thought of having to drag my kids to a hostel or a B&B, wow. That was horrendous. But now, obviously, I've got the flat, this temporary accommodation, rather than hostels or B&Bs. I can't describe how I'm feeling.
Also facing the threat of becoming homeless is Ray. He is due to be evicted and has come to see what help the council will give him.
I'm being evicted for no intention of my own. So, and I've spoke to people from the advice bureau and told them about my case, and they've said, by law, you've got duty of care to help me.
Now, whatever advice they're giving you is incorrect.
It's incorrect.
It's incorrect.
You ain't got duty of care to help me.
There's no such thing.
Why haven't you got duty of care to help me? I've been in the area for 5 years. I'm being evicted for no intention of my home.
Mm.
I'm not being evicted for anything I've done. I'm being evicted because the people want their flat back. So why can't you just help me now? Because you know you're going to have to help me when the bailiffs come and kick me out, if you choose to help me. So why can't you do that now?
OK. I understand your frustration. The thing is, we have to work within the remits of the law.
The council will not consider Ray as homeless until he receives a bailiff's warrant. But even when evicted, there are no guarantees he will be entitled to help, because people have to be assessed on whether they have a priority need.
What the council has to be satisfied is, if homeless, would you be at more risk than other homeless people?
So it means would I suffer more sleeping in the door than the next homeless person?
Exactly.
Oh, that's nice.
That's what the law is.
Is that what his government treats you as citizens?
That's
absolutely disgusting.
Okay, fair enough, but we have no, I have no power to change it.
I know you've got your boss.
They've made the law.
That's disgusting.
This is what
I cannot believe that our government would think of something like, is he more vulnerable in a doorway than the next person? That is disgusting. That makes me sick to my stomach. Literally, that is disgusting. Disgusting.
All right.
If I end up in the doorway, it's going to be this one, you know?
Hopefully it won't come to that, but you have to say we have to assess the application. I mean, everyone who applies as homeless has to be assessed on the same criteria.
People kind of think they're owed help, but the brutal fact is there's very strict criteria as to who's owed a housing duty.
Thank you.
Okay, right. So, yeah, that's pretty much it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. See you later.
See ya.
Bye. Bye.
I haven't left there feeling positive, just put it that way. I still get the impression that they're just trying to find ways not to help me, rather than help me. But as I say, nothing as yet has happened still. I've just been told it's... I've still got to wait, so it's still the waiting game.
While Ray remains uncertain about his fate, Lacey is about to see her new home for the first time. The council rents hundreds of private properties to use as emergency accommodation for homeless families. The rent on this three-bed flat is £338 a week. The benefit cap has cut Lacey's housing benefit to just £217. But the council's desire to house families locally, where possible, means the rest of her rent will be paid for by the council's special fund.
What's happening is that people are renting in the private sector. They have some reliance on housing benefit. Welfare reforms are coming in that limit that person's benefit entitlement. Landlords are evicting those families. They come to the council, and the public purse has to pay significantly more to assist that family.
It looks exactly the same as what I've just moved out of, just a bit nicer, I suppose. Let's have a quick look around. And then this will be the girls' bedroom. Their bunk beds will go along there. This will be the living room. Sofa's there. Nice coffee table and a rug there. I can't wait.
By being moved here, Lacey can stay on the waiting list for a permanent council property in the borough. But she is one of the lucky ones. For hundreds of families facing cuts to their benefits, rises in private rents and eviction, the future is bleak.
You know, the heart's going to be ripped out of the borough, with a lot of people who closely identify with Tower Hamlets being forced to move way out of the area. We're going to be left with people who can afford the private rents, working professionals earning fairly decent money, and the few people who are able to afford their own homes. The vast majority of people who are on low incomes and on benefits aren't going to be around anymore. I can't say whether it will make the area better or worse, but I can say, you know, it's not going to be as it is. In even in 2 years' time, the makeup is going to be very different.
The series continues next week at the same time of 9 o'clock, and support information for the issues raised can be found at channel4.com/support. Next tonight, a year on and featuring unique FBI access, the hunt for the Boston bombers, the police search, and the media's appetite for a story.
But the waiting list is based on a complex calculation that takes into account the amount of time a person is in the queue and also their level of need.
Well, we're here to make sure that the people that deserve the property and the people that who are in great need are those that we assess and place on the housing list.
30-year-old teaching assistant Sabrina still lives at home with her mum.
Right, this room here is my bedroom. It's the biggest room in the house. Spend most of my time in this room. And here's the smallest room, which is my nephew's bedroom.
Sabrina has lived in this four-bedroom house all her life.
This is my mother's room. And we have another bedroom, but that's our laundry room.
Sabrina's mother owns this property, but now Sabrina wants a place of her own.
It's just independence. That's the only reason why I want to move on. I'm happy where I live, but I'm 30 now, and I would like to have my own space. Let's see what they have here.
Almost every week for the past 12 years, Sabrina has been bidding for council properties. She's seen places like this one-bed flat, available for £123 a week, and this ground floor two-bed flat for £125 a week come and go, because she is considered low priority by the council.
I don't think the system works really well, because I know others that have been on the list after me and has got a place, so I don't see the fairness in that. And on top of that, she's on benefits. So how can you be on the list after me, not working for it, and you get a place? If we're working for it, we should be first priority. Not people that are living on our money as it is already, living off my tax money.
...44-year-old Ray, whose only income is from benefits, is facing eviction and urgently needs to find new accommodation. Staying in Tower Hamlets depends on him getting a council house or finding a private rental flat that he can afford with his housing benefit.
had it up. 315, one bedroom apartment. I'll get 240 a week. The cheapest flat for me here in this shop window is 285 a week. On my income support, I don't get enough to pay for that. It's absolutely impossible. So I've got no chance in this place.
But finding an affordable flat is only half the challenge.
150 a week, 130 a week, double room. But it looks really nice. Oh, bloody hell. Sorry, no DSSS. No point in stopping here then. No DSSS. So the ones what are reasonably priced, they don't accept the HSS. And the ones what charge diabolical prices accept the HSS. Fantastic. Can I ask you, do you take people who are on benefits?
We do, but at the moment I don't have anything.
Oh.
You know, when we take on properties, we do ask landlord whether they would accept tenants on benefits.
Do you have any idea why some of them do and some of them don't?
Some just don't want the hassle because some of them think people who are on benefit, they don't look after the properties.
So would you say that it would probably be hard for me to get somewhere then?
Right now it's going to be hard because there isn't a lot of properties around. You know, the demand has really gone up. People with the money are pushing the poor out from the, especially into hamlets. It's kind of a cleansing of the poor.
We're facing the perfect storm. We have rents shooting up, rocketing up, in fact, out of the reaches of people on benefits. And we have letting agents and landlords who aren't interested in renting their properties to people on benefits. So, you know, nobody who's benefit dependent and not in a permanent property will be able to live in Tower Hamlets. And this is going to happen in the next 6 to 12 months.
One of those facing sizable cuts to her benefits is Sabina. Unemployed and with 5 children, the benefit cap leaves her facing a shortfall in her rent of £267 a week. She's come to the conclusion that she has to find somewhere cheaper to live.
We're moving to Barking today because the benefit cap they've done, it's too expensive and it's too high rent to live in Tower Hamlets, so we've decided to move to Barking.
Although Barking is just 7 miles away, rent prices are cheaper, but it means a big adjustment for the family.
It's quite difficult and quite sad because, like, there'll be, like, people missing us and everything, and, like, it's going to be kind of weird moving to Barking because there ain't that many people that I know that live around there, so, yeah.
By moving out of the borough, Sabina loses her position on the Tower Hamlets waiting list.
How are you feeling?
Not that bad.
Are you sad to be leaving Tower Hamlets, though?
Yeah. It's not fair because just had to start all over again.
Without a benefit cap, you know, I would have not moved, to be honest. But because they've done a benefit cap, I had to move. I've got no choice.
Sabina may have left the borough, but the council officers had to deal with an average of 35 new applicants joining the waiting list every week.
Okay,
so
you're
gonna...
That's good, you're attending
interviews.
Excellent.
Single mother Lacey is one of those desperate for a council house. She and her 3 children are faced with eviction in just under 2 weeks' time. After bidding for a 2-bedroom housing association place, Lacey has found out that she's 3rd on the list for the property.
nervous, excited. I don't know, mixed emotions, because I don't want to build my hopes up too much. There's two people in front of me that could potentially accept the property. Fingers crossed they don't.
The property is a maisonette on the seventh floor of this tower block.
I quite like the outside, it looks quite cool.
On the private rental market, two-bed flats in the area average around £379 a week.
I have a jet, and it's now 11:30. I don't know if they're giving me time to wake up or giving me time to move out.
Ray is desperate for his own council house. Out of work because of health issues, the rent for his bedsit is paid for by housing benefits.
Because I've got a 14-year-old son, and I haven't seen him since he's 1.5, which is really quite sad, but I live with it today. I've done a lot of crying over it and a lot of thinking about it, but now it's something I just live with. And, you know, I think being settled and being in a place where I can do up and, you know, make look nice and all that, just in case one day my son contacts me. You know, which would be really great, which I wish would happen and pray would happen every single night.
After losing all contact with his son, Ray's life spiralled out of control.
I was basically a crackhead and drink dependent and all that, and I ended up getting arrested for drink driving, and I went to prison for it, thank God. You know, we get punished for the things we do.
Now clean and sober, if Ray is evicted, he'll have nowhere else to go. After standing guard for most of the morning, he takes matters into his own hands.
I'm going to phone my landlord now and see what's happening. Is he going to send someone around today to board it up or whatever, you know? Like, how long does the bailiff take? Oh, no, you're joking.
Is that right?
Oh, my God. I've got plenty of time. Why didn't I just phone them up in the first place? They've said to me that they've applied to go to court for the bailiffs, but that could take anything up to 3 months. That just gives me more time to sort things out with the council.
Ray's had a stay of execution, but his best hope of staying in Tower Hamlets is to find a council property. He's been on a waiting list and bidding for a place for 7 years, but so far with no luck.
The way the bidding system works is that we have a list of proper accommodations that become available each week. The applicants then make an informed decision as to whether or not they wish to be considered for that particular property by placing a bid.
People's position in the queue is determined by their level of need and how long they've been on the list.
There's a new one, and there's 67 people in front of me.
How long does that mean you've got to wait?
I don't know, 6 or 7 years. I don't know. Until 67 people die, or I don't know, what's it mean? I'm a vulnerable person, I'm an ex-addict, I'm an ex-alcoholic, and I'm stuck in this system, and it's really frustrating. You know, there's lots of questions to be asked about this system, but the main one is, can I have a flat, please?
Tower Hamlets in East London is one of the most densely populated boroughs in Britain. With the cost of rental prices rising by 16% in the last year, living here is becoming unaffordable for anyone who is on benefits and out of work. And this is putting an enormous strain on the council's housing office.
Afternoon, Sir Patrick Evans, Tower Hamlets.
Demand is increasing. Supply is dropping. individual's financial ability to pay is also dropping. I do think there is a crisis looming. Our job is to try and minimise the impact of that crisis.
Where did I put the hair clips? I had loads this morning. Oh, they're in my hair. I put them in my hair so I wouldn't lose them. And then I lost them. Come quick, because that sun's in my eyes.
For the past 3 years, single mother Lacey has been living in this privately rented three-bedroom flat with her two daughters and son, who has recently been diagnosed with autism. The property costs £365 a week to rent. But the benefit cap leaves Lacey with only £217 a week to spend on housing.
The benefit cap, I don't see how that's working at all, because you're pushing me back and standing on me and keeping me there rather than helping me go in the right direction where I should be going into terms of finding a job.
For lone parents, getting just 16 hours a week of work would see them qualify for working tax credit and stop their benefits being capped.
16 hours seems like it's a realistic amount of hours to work, but who's going to have the kids while you're at working?
Unless Lacey can find employment, her best prospect of staying in the borough is to get a council property.
Let's have a quick look and see where you are. I would say you're doing quite well with it, because there was a property you bid for in January that you came number 6, which was very good. This property here. All I can say is when you bid for property, just be flexible in terms of the area, in terms of the level of property. But finger crossed, you know, it might be something coming through to you.
So there's a chance?
There is a chance, but it's just the urgency in your case.
Although Lacey's position on the waiting list is encouraging, her need to find somewhere has become critical. Her landlord has issued her with a bailiff's warrant, and she's due to be evicted in just under 2 weeks' time.
Yeah, the clock's ticking. Oh, fast. Because in less than 2 weeks, I'm going to be homeless, and my three kids are going to be homeless. Well, I'm struggling to sort of keep on top of it and keep, you know, keep my head sort of together.
Lacey returned to her home borough of Tower Hamlets and went on benefits after splitting from her husband, who was in the armed forces.
I suppose at the minute my biggest fear is social services maybe stepping in and getting involved. You know, I mean, they're not involved as of now, but I don't know, that's my biggest fear. That's the strongest fear. Ready? Steady, let's go. Coming out quick. Just waiting, seeing what turns up. Keep applying for jobs, keep my head up. Try and keep a smile on my face for my kids. And just keep going.
Providing they've been living in the borough for 3 years, anyone can apply for a council house in Tower Hamlets. Through the Housing Association, this maisonette is being offered at a far more affordable £139. But Lacey needs two other families to turn it down before she can take it.
How hopeful are you?
I've lost hope. This is a step in the right direction, but again, I'm number 3, you know?
If Lacey doesn't get this property, she and her children will be evicted and homeless in less than 2 weeks' time. The government's benefit cuts are aimed at encouraging people back to work. Unemployed family households can now only claim a maximum of £500 a week. In Tower Hamlets, it means many will be unable to cover their rent. And the council's housing office has been working all hours with people to assess what their options will be when the cap takes effect.
I just called to get an update on your housing situation.
OK, it's just about your benefit cap, because obviously, you know, that might be a problem with regards to your rent.
I've been trying to get in touch with you for quite some time regarding your housing situation. Just over a third of tenants that I've contacted have got back to me, and I'm quite concerned that there are still a number of people who aren't engaging. So I'm going to need to start doing home visits, do a bit of door knocking to explain to them that, you know, they're in a situation that's unsustainable.
The emergency money the council had set aside to cover the rent of struggling households will soon be gone, leaving hundreds in rent arrears.
I'm just putting a card through the door with my details on, because she's obviously not at home. There is a massive dilemma here because, you know, you have people who are on benefits, they've been established in the community for a number of years, but unfortunately the areas are so expensive now that if you can't afford to pay the rent, you need to do as everyone else does and move to an affordable area. Hi there, my name is Brian from Tower Hamlets Council. I'll talk to you about your housing benefit for a few minutes. Cheers, thank you very much.
26-year-old Billy is a single mother of four boys, all aged under eight.
This is Sunny and Charlie. Charlie's got a twin brother, he's seven. Little baby Thomas with yogurt on him. Yeah.
Billy currently lives in this privately rented three-bedroom house, which costs £369 a week. She used to pay for this out of her £716 a week benefits.
I never wanted to ever be on benefits in the first place. But, you know, for some people, there comes a time when you have to swallow your pride and go to the dole office, which is what happened for me. It's not something that I ever planned, you know.
Hello, Billy.
The whole world thinks that anyone who claims benefits is a bum and lazy and doesn't want to work. And that's not the case for everybody. You know, there's some people who do claim benefits because they need to, because there isn't another option for people like me. When my youngest son is old enough to go to school, there'll be nothing stopping me from spending every minute of every day trying to find employment.
The benefit cap will leave Billy with just £152 a week to cover her rent.
OK, so you're facing a rent shortfall of £216.86 a week, which is one of the larger rent shortfalls that I'm dealing with. Not the largest that I have, but it's top end.
So far, the council's emergency fund has covered Billy's rent. But once that money runs out, Billy and her children will have to move to a cheaper private property.
There's nowhere within the M25 or even, you know, within the majority of this area that we can place you apart from right on the outskirts. Yeah. So it will be a big move rather than around the corner move.
Billy and her children's best chance of staying in the area is to secure a council property, which could cut her weekly rent by up to a half. But she's been bidding since she was 18, with no success.
I bid every week, and they do say that if you don't miss any bids, you bid every week, that you'll go further and further up the list. Which I just don't see any evidence of it. I've been bidding for 9 years. And I'm still waiting. It just hasn't happened.
Okay, nice meeting you.
Unless Billy's luck changes in the next 2 months, she and her children face being uprooted from their home in Tower Hamlets.
Why do I have to be moved 20 miles away from anything that I've ever known to bring up four kids in isolation, which is what it would feel like?
Take care, speak soon.
It feels like I can't control my future or my children's, and that boils down to me feeling like a bad mum.
Yeah.
Single mother of three, Lacey, is facing eviction from her privately rented flat, but recently had the chance to view a housing association property. She was hopeful it would give her and her children a new home, but she's received bad news.
That flat, I didn't get accepted for it because I was third on the list and the first people accepted it. Starting from scratch again, starting from square one, having my hopes built up for something and then not getting it, you know?
The family's possessions are being moved into storage. Tomorrow, they will be evicted.
The moving man took the bed and a radio.
Lacey and her children are on the brink of becoming homeless, but she's trying to keep the news from them.
It's tough, you know, pretending everything's normal, everything's fine. I just told her that we've got to move out of here because the landlord wants to move back into his property, so we might have to stay in a hotel. So I've made it sound like it's going to be fun. Told him that we have to share a kitchen and possibly a bathroom. So Aaron, being Aaron, my son, he asked if we was living with homeless people. So, yeah, we are, but obviously I ain't told him that. Because we're also homeless. Obviously he don't know that.
After 12 years on the waiting list, teaching assistant Sabrina has been given the chance to view a flat.
My first impressions at the moment, the area seems okay. It's a quiet area. From the outside, it looks okay, but it depends what the inside looks like, to be honest with you.
This is the bedroom. It's quite spacious for a one-bedroom flat. It's
really
nice.
It's all right. Yeah, it's a nice size.
Okay, let me show you the living room. It's really quite spacious as well.
Actually, this one's all right, this room, yeah.
Right, the kitchen's a newly refurbished kitchen with new units, new cupboards, new flooring, new tiles.
On the private market, one-bedroom flats like this in the area could cost £400 a week. But Sabrina is being offered it for just £155.
I'm just trying to work by my monthly wages and trying to subtract all the things that will be coming out of my account. The rent, gas, electric. And it's quite a bit. This is beautiful, but it's out of my price range. £300 to live on a month is peanuts, yeah. That's nonsense.
So is this going to be a no then?
Yeah, it's going to have to be a no.
It's a shame.
Basically, I'll just be working to pay bills. That will be my wages. Every month will be paying bills. That's it. The lifestyle that I live now and the things that I do now, I won't be able to do. But I'm just going to continue bidding, have patience, wait, hopefully another one like this will come along, but within my price range.
Tower Hamlet have set a table for how much we can charge. So whatever we charge for one bedroom or two bedroom properties would be a target that has been set within the borough. So she's not gonna get anything cheaper than this around the borough. So I just wish her the best.
While Sabrina is back to bidding, single mother of four, Billy, has had some good news. After 9 years on the council waiting list, she's been given the chance to view a flat. Joining Billy on her viewing today are her youngest son, Tom, and her brother, Eric.
I've been wondering sort of stupid scenarios, like when I get there, what if they say, oh no, we've changed our mind? What if they say, oh, somebody else has got more priority than you, so you're back down the list again? I know it's stupid, but I know it just doesn't feel real yet.
In the last 4 years, the council has built 4,000 new houses. Billy's going to view a three-bedroom property in a new housing association development that will contain 208 flats.
There is still building going on, as you can see. So it's actually brand new. Oh, this looks amazing. Look, the balconies aren't finished. The balconies aren't even on. So it's literally brand new. There's no one's ever lived in it before. I will be the first. I just want to get in there now. I literally just want to get in there and see what it's like.
Because building work is still underway, Billy has to leave her son and brother outside and view the property on her own. On the private rental market, the starting price for a three-bed flat in this area is around £470 a week. Circle Housing offered this at a reduced rent of £168 a week, around £200 cheaper than her current accommodation. In 2 months' time, 62 social housing homes will open in this block, and Billy and her family will move into one of them.
It's really nice, it's lovely. The bedrooms are all nice size. The bedrooms are all bigger than my bedrooms at home. That's the kitchen and the living room.
The kitchen's big.
It's nice, isn't it?
Look.
It means that we're going to be happy now. We're going to be happy and comfortable. I can leave all my stress behind and start, you know, being happy and making a life for us all.
As Billy Jo looks forward to moving in, Ray is anxious about having to move out. He's due to be evicted from his bedsit and is heading to the council for help.
I haven't got anyone else I can go to, so if they don't help me, I'm just going to pitch a tent outside the office and live there. Because that's my only option. I've got a roof over my head at this precise moment in time, but I'm being evicted and I never made myself intentionally evicted. So if you think that, oh, look at this geezer, he's got a roof over his head, what is it, what's he moaning about? And guess what, fuck you.
Single mum Lacey was evicted from her privately rented flat this morning. With her children at school, she's come into the council office to see what emergency housing they can provide.
All right, thank you.
We've always been proud of our ability to house our homeless families in Borough. But that's becoming increasingly difficult. And we're finding ourselves now searching accommodation outside of our own borough boundaries. And you can imagine the consequences of that to our homeless families.
The stress is unreal. Because obviously you've got to take into consideration how the kids are feeling. You know, I'm responsible for my three kids, solely responsible for my three kids. So I have to take that seriously. So yeah, how this affects me is going to affect them. And the stress, I can't put it into words, the stress.
Lacey to booth 17.
Because she has children, Lacey knows the council are obliged to find her emergency accommodation.
Thank you.
Hi, Lacey. My name's Mohammed.
But depending on what's available, it could be anything from a house in the borough to a bed and breakfast in another part of the country.
Originally, we did have plans to put you into a B&B accommodation. But thankfully, you've been given a temporary accommodation. You know, it doesn't happen on many occasions, but when it does happen, you know, this is quite rare. So that's a good result for us, yeah. No problem.
Cheers,
so, take care. See ya.
Temporary accommodation is usually a self-contained flat in which a family can live until a permanent place becomes available.
Very relieved. The thought of having to drag my kids to a hostel or a B&B, wow. That was horrendous, but now...
There are 5 million homes in Britain, provided at reduced rent through local councils.
Yes, yeah, a nice size.
A further 4.5 million people are on the waiting list for somewhere to live.
Now I will take anything, because I'd take anything rather than be on the streets.
I'm a worker, so I think I should be one of the first priorities.
With the government cutting benefits for unemployed households and private rental prices hitting new heights,
bloody hell,
demand for council housing has gone through the roof.
Yeah, the clock's ticking fast.
95 people in front of me in this. I don't know, what's the point of applying for it? What's the point?
There's this misconception that, oh, it's all right, the council will sort me out. Not anymore.
These people all want a home. But who needs it the most?
There's two people in front of me that could accept the property. Fingers crossed they don't.
Tower Hamlets in East London. A host borough for the Olympics, it's now one of the most expensive places to buy or rent property in the UK. But it's also one of the poorest areas in the country. For many facing cuts to their benefits because of government welfare reforms, it's becoming almost impossible to afford to live here.
The benefit cap has been implemented by the government, and it limits people who are out of work to a maximum of £500 a week for a family or £350 a week for a single person.
The government argues the cap will encourage unemployed people back to work and reduce the UK's soaring welfare bill.
It's predicted that by the end of 2015, we're going to be spending £22 billion a year just on housing benefit. Now, that's not sustainable.
For those who can't find work, the best hope of staying in the borough is to secure a council house, where rents can be significantly cheaper. Property that's soon to become available include a two-bed maisonette on the seventh floor of this tower block for £139 a week. This recently refurbished one-bed flat for £155 a week. And this three-bed flat with city views in a brand new complex for £168 a week. But competition for places is fierce.
How are you getting on with your search?
Still the same.
Very hard, isn't it?
I would say it's almost impossible.
20,000 households are looking for a council property in Tower Hamlets, fighting for just 2,000 available places a year.
I don't want to jump the queue, but I'm just hoping that they'll be able to help me, and if they can't, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Brian and the team have hundreds of households on their books that are being affected by the cap.
Sabina to interview room 16, please.
Today he's meeting 34-year-old Sabina.
Hey, yeah.
Hi there. Take a seat, please.
Sabina's been on the council house waiting list for just over 4 years.
So how long is the wait on mine then?
I'll show you your bidding at the moment. So you've got a 304, a 509 and a 314. You don't get to view properties until you achieve top three or top five queue positions. So I would say that we're talking several years. And the reality is, unless you've got 8 to 10 years bidding on the list, you don't stand a chance. You don't stand any chance at all of getting housed. But people don't want to hear that.
Sabina currently lives in a privately rented four-bedroom house with her husband and 5 children.
She likes making funny faces.
As they're both out of work, they're entirely dependent on benefits and were previously entitled to £767 a week. Now their total benefits have been cut to just £500 a week.
You're going to have your breakfast now. Is it nice? Yum, yum.
The rent on Sabina's property is currently £375 a week. But once she's paid for all her bills and household costs, A cap of £500 will leave her with just £84 for rent.
Not very happy about it, really, at all. With five kids, it's really difficult to cut down on food, clothing and stuff, and it's not just hitting myself, it's just hitting the kids as well.
The council have been covering the £267 a week shortfall in Sabina's rent out of its emergency funds. But that money is running out.
Realistically, with the £500 cap, that property is no longer viable for you to live in.
But if we do find ourselves a property...
I don't see how you're going to do that.
Because what we do is, because obviously my husband's going to start work, and in between we're just paying with our benefit money and stuff.
Yeah, but you're only getting £88 a week in housing benefit?
Yeah, and then we pay the rest with the benefit money.
So where are you...
The child tax, child benefit, and then job seeker.
It's just not sustainable. You know, that's not what that money's meant for.
Right.
You know, so that means you putting your family through hardship to use the money that should be spent on their clothes and food and whatever else on rent.
But I've got money left over to pay the bills and stuff because I just got to cut on the, you know, sort of like extra mobiles and Sky and all this.
You've still got Sky?
Yeah.
Okay. Those were the kind of expenses I would have said you needed to...
expensive stuff I could cut off.
Yeah.
And then sort of, you know.
I think Tower Hamlets is too expensive for you.
You
can't pay that indefinitely.
Because obviously the situation's going to change because my husband's going to get a job and I'm going to get a sort of like 16 hours a week job.
I deal with people every day who say, I'm going to find a job. 18 months later, they haven't found a job. So, you know, financially, is it worth you staying in London?
I'm shocked that he said to move outside of London because, you know, you can't get a job up there and you've got no families and stuff to support. And you've got sort of like, it's going to be difficult to get a work and then find a childcare.
It's a financial motivation that the government's decided upon. So if you want to live in the most expensive part of the most expensive city in the country, they think that you need to be contributing to the economy. If you're not able to do that, then unfortunately you're going to have to move.
44-year-old Londoner Ray has lived in Tower Hamlets for 8 years. He currently lives in an ex-council bedsit, bought under the right to buy scheme, but his landlord wants to refurbish it and has told Ray to leave today.
I'm worried that they might have the audacity to try and come round and actually force me out of the house, you know. It hasn't